Parental discretion is advised.
This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Just wait, just wait. Hey guys, it's the Wrestling Mayhem Show 516. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter from the beautiful Mayhem Studios here in Pittsburgh, PA, a mere miles away from a near death and carnage of Hell in a Cell. I need to figure out something else that's happened in Pittsburgh to announce. But we're here to talk pro wrestling and the like on the flagship of WrestlingMayhemShow.com. With me, the crew has amassed. We are in the studio. The lights are still on. No, we didn't have a problem with the lights. The power is fine and mostly paid up. The internet is on, and we are streaming at live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com to our fine spectators in the chat rooms. And with me on the internets that actually work, Eamon Payton. At Eamon 2, please, on the Twitter. He is the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling and good friend of Johnny Mundo.
God, stop saying that.
I'm going to say it. More I say it.
Every time you say it,
it'll become true. And then you'll be parkouring across the rooftops of Austin, Texas with him.
Yeah, that'll happen.
One day.
And not necessarily anything about him, but my physical ability. But no.
Start today.
Yeah, I'm excited to be back. I'm excited to not be hosting the show this week.
You did a wonderful job, by the way.
Anyone who watched 515. I'm sorry.
Get your money back.
Hey, man, I watched it. It was fine.
Aww. It was wonderful. It was wonderful, good sir. As you heard that voice, it is the sounds of the Renegade Wrestling Alliance. The sound guy, Wheels, Hot Wheels RWA on the Twitters. How you doing, sir?
I'm doing pretty good. I don't know if I'm the sounds of...
It works.
RWA, because I could not do 186 crazy rabid fans. No, I mean, not at once. I mean, I'd sound like a howler monkey or something. But I do the sound for the music and the docile sounds of Burt LeGrand when he does his ring announcing and the crowd's not booing him.
Docile.
Ooh. Wow.
That's great.
And then there's the voice of the Renegade Wrestling Alliance in the ring.
Doing the Isaac.
Old school Burt LeGrand.
Welcome, Sorg. Thank you for having me. This is great. This is great. Sorgatron Manor. This is a beautiful place.
Thank you.
You got the monkey. This is beautiful.
Thank you. You've seen me outside? Okay. This is not your first time on this show, right?
This is my third time on the show. Second time in Sorgatron Manor.
There you go. Join us with the pro wrestling old school knowledge. Going to be talking today. Thank you so much for joining us. And also, since I missed Renegade Wrestling Alliance, and
damn
also
right you did.
Also I nearly missed. By the way, I was in Tennessee and I'm on my way back driving to the airport on Monday, and I stopped at a rest stop and I found a poster for a wrestling show.
Oh, wow.
I was trying so hard to find a wrestling show in Tennessee.
Sure.
And it was featuring Jeff Jarrett, who was just in Meadville a week before.
Oh,
wow.
Because it's Tennessee, right?
Right, of course.
And nobody else I recognize. I took a picture of it. I need to go find out. I'll pull it up for Indie Mayhem show later, I think. Nice. Remind me, Eamon. But anyways, I forgot where I was going from there. This is a Wrestling Mayhem Show. That's what we're doing. WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Subscribe to this and all so many other shows on iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, newly on the Google Play podcast place.
Lovely.
Search for it. Scroll to the bottom of the page. Don't try it on the app yet. Hopefully very, very soon. But please subscribe to that. And I actually do recommend you to subscribe to all your favorite podcasts on the Google Music. Even if you don't end up using the Google Music app, help them out. And even our friends like Should I Drink That, the Scarehouse podcast, Katie Dutters, that was on a few weeks ago. That's her podcast. We don't know what Google's going to do with these. And help people get a hot start to Google Music as a platform. Subscribe to them. If there's a, I don't even know if there's a rating mechanism or comments or anything, but put that on there.
It's all Wild West so far.
Copy and paste your comment you've already definitely made on iTunes and put it over there on Google Music. And you don't need an iPhone or an Android to do it. Just go to music.google.com and you probably all have Google accounts and you can get into it. So go do that. Support that and especially support this show as well. Also, youtube.com/WrestlingMayhemShow and the Facebook page. The Facebook group for Wrestling Mayhem Show videos are being shared on there of the shows. And thank you to our Patreon subscribers, of which I'm trying to find a list, but I know who's always there. That's first of all the WrestlingRevolution.com. Mr. Garza from El Paso is the longtime Patreon supporter. Thank you so much for that. Also, almost forgot. Bo Diggity! Help us with the show I'll say it like that. The Jennifer and Matthew Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment, Ed Burke, and I don't know if the fifth person is Alex Cars or Matt Mike, so I'm just gonna roll with both of them. Thank you so much, guys. I'm pretty sure it's Alex. So I'm so sorry, Patreon changed things and they buried like the list. And I can't
really
easily bring it up anymore. And I just noticed the number was different, so I haven't been able to check that out. So apologies for that. So somebody got extra notified. That's okay. They're part of the show anyways. And also you can drop us a line at Good Times.
Good Times.
Good Times.
Good Times.
Thank you. Good Times at WrestlingMayhemShow.com, 412-206-WMS0. And you can join us here live at WrestlingMayhemShow.com with the chat room and the live stream and the stuff we don't talk about on the show. All right, let's get into it, into the show. It was a very, we've been very astonished lately at Monday Night Raw and how things have gone. The Shane O'Mac factor, the New Faces factor, and I noticed last night. Did anybody else notice how much they were saying arrival last night on Monday Night Raw?
In fairness, I do not pay attention to commentary.
You don't. But I was watching Raw at 30,000 feet, so I was very much paying attention to the commentary. Sensory, which actually,
aware.
What's that?
Sensory aware.
Yes, yes. The elevation does not elevate all of the commentary, but it definitely makes you have to pay attention to it. I watched the first Raw that way, caught up with the second half of it. Very, very, very right on the dot, an hour and a half into it, actually. I caught up the rest of it this morning, and again, kind of catching up more than I usually do on commentary. And I don't know if they've been doing this in the past, because I watch a lot like you guys and maybe not so much attention to the commentary. But I think they're very much acknowledging that this is the NXT era.
Absolutely.
Of Raw.
Absolutely.
And if you look at up and down, I mean, what do you think?
I think so. I mean, the presence is there. I think give any card on either Raw or SmackDown or Mania or any pay-per-view, or whatever the, what's the terminology now? They're not pay-per-views anymore. Special events, right?
Yeah.
On the network.
Yeah.
Every match has an NXT alumni on it or multiple at the very least one.
Right.
And that's, a testament to what they've been able to do and relatively quickly with the NXT brand, with the Performance Center, with bringing people up. And a lot of those people, they already come, with the factory installed ability, but, it just goes to show you how quickly they can adapt and ramp up everybody with the WWE style. And I think it's a very welcome change because, there's always a buzz post-Mania in terms of, the reset button and getting everything on board. But here it seems even more fresher than usual with all the different energies that are out there. Not just performers, not just characters, but I'm noticing the energies. It's a different energy with each of the performers.
And it also just feels like a completely different format to the show.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if obviously it's still a 3-hour show, and it's in that sense it's the same sort of format. But like my favorite stuff from last night, I love they did that Apollo Crews video, like that they never do. They never do like videos just to showcase like a talent or give a closer look at somebody, which I think would be so useful. And NXT's proven that. Those things are super useful.
Right. And the only time they do those things are to hype them up before they debut. They never do it 3 or 4 weeks into a guy's tenure.
Mm-hmm.
And it's refreshing though, and it breaks up some of the stuff that you have in like a 3-hour show. Like I think that's nice, and I wish they'd do more of that. But it's not even just the like actual performers themselves, just what they're doing with them. The whole, you know, the fact that we didn't go for the obvious choices in that tag title tournament, right, and now right. Enzo and Cass are wrestling the Vaudevillains in the finals, like,
yeah,
which I don't think a lot of people expected.
And guaranteeing somebody different will face the New Day
right.
in the end, yeah, right?
And they beat like, the two established teams in like the Dudleys and the Usos.
Right.
Like, I think that, you know, those are the two teams that they always go to.
Am I the only person, and I'm never one to fantasy book, but am I the only person who sees the Bullet Club getting involved in that final and them being the ones to face the New Day? I know they're currently involved in the Reigns and AJ Styles thing and that, but am I seeing that? Because I think they could save the Vaudevillains down the road. They could definitely save Enzo and Cass down the road. That's something you build towards. Enzo's promos against the New Day are going to be off the chain. But right. I think it's something they could do right now, immediately, Bullet Club and New Day. Fresh, I mean, very fresh, of course, but I think it's something they could definitely do right now.
It's a whole lineup.
That's my dark horse pick for what's going to happen.
Yeah,
going forward.
Yeah, but also, I mean, going to that whole like NXT kind of style of Raw now. Obviously, they weren't in NXT, but the fact that like one of the top stories right now on Raw is the whole AJ Styles and Bullet Club stuff,
right.
Which is something that obviously they are directly saying it's the Bullet Club, but to mention somebody's past history and that has been completely done in another company,
yeah,
is so different for them. Yeah,
exactly. Well, even a little bit. I've been thinking about that when they were was watching the main event, I think, last night, and they were referencing the Kevin Owens, Sami Zayn storied history that's mm-hmm. happened for so long, and realizing if you want the rest of that history, you need to go buy some Ring of Honor DVDs.
Right,
you know, exactly. like if you really want to, like, right. I'm thinking about that every time they reference back to, I think of that Ladder War show that they did, which was like the ender of their feud, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, it was like their last Ring of Honor match.
Yeah, which again is a little bit of, and if you were somebody that knows what that is, you have that little bit of insider tick. Like, it's a little bit of, again, you know, randomly I've been watching some like WCW around when Hogan came in, and basically a bunch of WWF guys were coming in
right.
To WCW, and they would still reference all the stuff they've done, and now they're here.
Sure.
Like, and WWE's doing that, like, just like WCW in 1993.
I think, you know, it's obviously a different time. It's 23 years later, but
right.
it's WWE universe beats the universe.
Right.
And you realize in the times that we're in, you know, it's not that big a leap. You say, oh, Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn have this long history. It's not that big a leap to, okay, that's neat. Go on your laptop, go on your phone, do whatever, go on your tablet, and say, okay, well, you know, Google Kevin Owens, Google Sami Zayn, YouTube it, Wikipedia it. You know, it's literally, you're a minute away from the entire history, and as you want to consume mm-hmm. it.
And it's throwing a bone to, you know, obviously guys like Ring of Honor, Evolve, IWC, RWA are exactly. like, hey, Corey Graves, he was here.
Right.
You know, hey, right. this guy, he was here.
Right.
The Lugan Chulo, the Drifter, Elias Samson was here, you know, whatever the case may be.
Right.
So that still referencing something like that throws a bone to like a Ring of Honor.
I remember there was a, this is slightly off topic, but also very much on topic. I remember back when Beth Phoenix was debuting in mm-hmm. WWE, and mm-hmm. she was going through developmental that time, OVW, and she was a valet in OVW, but also, you know, going through the motion, the performance to be a performer in the WWE, we got notification. I think it was Drew Lazario had notified us that, hey, there's a chance they might be using her video with, at the time, Alexis Lurie, became Mickie James, for that video, the stuff that like I was doing commentary on, like that could be used. I mean, never came to fruition, but mm-hmm. you know, there was that sort of thing. So I mean, they were doing it even back in 2005, 2006. The seeds were being planted.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think that's, you know, that reference like that, you know, it's interesting. And well, even to the point where it wasn't, there was a tweet last week about matches from, was it Progress? Got announced.
Evolve and Progress. Cause they're both hosting Global Cruiserweight Series.
Right. Right.
Qualifying
right. And what an interesting way to do that. And obviously, what Revolution Pro, I know we've seen a lot of footage, especially when it comes to, like, you don't see New Japan stuff. When Baylor and Nakamura came in, it's Revolution Pro in the UK, right?
Yeah.
I thought it was always kind of interesting. Obviously, there's already a relationship there, so I imagine they'll probably get some of these things as well. But and Progress is not somebody I've heard a lot of, right?
Absolutely. And that you're getting that now for the first time. I mean, yeah, it's been there, but now you're getting it, you know, it's almost like a, you know, wash your hand, I'll wash your, you know, you wash mine. And it's, you know, is it Triple H is doing? Is that something else? I mean, it's not Vince's, mm-hmm. but is that, you know, is that that influence coming in that finally acknowledge that, yes, there are other groups. They're not a threat to take over anything anytime soon, but they can at least build and at least build to our story, these different ancillary right. groups from all around.
There's a little bit of a foreshadowing for Indie Mayhem Show this week, but we had the Matt Carlin's actually had a chance to talk with Booker T at the IWC Meadville show.
Ah.
That's going to be on this week's show.
Very nice.
And he did discuss a little bit about, you know, and this is a common, you know, discussion of, you know, there was the territories and everybody was ready for prime time by time they got to prime time TV with WWE or WCW or whatever the case was. And like this idea that these indies, you know, again, we've talked about a long time, maybe there should be a different name for all these, are to the point where they are giving guys like a Kevin Owens / Steen or a Sami Zayn / El Generico ? You know, the seeds to just roll right in
Absolutely.
And right up to a match with John Cena within like 3 months, right?
Absolutely.
Or AJ
Styles. And why shouldn't they? You
yeah, know, exactly.
They built this reputation right. and they've built this selling point. I mean, Kevin Owens, you know, not only, you know, yeah, he, you know, people on the indies knew who he was, but like he came into WWE and I'd have to, you know, check numbers and stuff like that. But I would bet he's one of like the top merchandise sellers.
Yeah.
Currently. Oh, sure. Sure.
Like I can't tell you how many Kevin Owens t-shirts I see in indie wrestling shows.
And that's so, that's what counts.
And even
at the end of the day, that's what counts.
Even on television too. Just look at the crowd on TV. I mean, you see the New Day shirts, you see Kevin Owens, you don't see as many Cena as before. I know it was a Big E that sent the tweet yesterday about New Day's
top sellers
on Mania weekend with the New Day. New Day merch was a top seller.
Wow.
Yeah, on WrestleMania weekend.
Of 100,000.
Right.
So we've been splitting three ways. They're kind of doing okay right now.
Yeah, they're doing
now,
okay
right?
by themselves.
Good for Kofi.
Right.
You know, in the long run, good for Kofi.
Good for Kofi.
Finally, stick it with them.
And they said it themselves. They're selling, you know, unicorn horns and boxes of cereal.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
That's crazy. Like, but, you know, they've sold it because of their work and because right. of the stuff that they put into their actual.
Was it Big E that, that said, thank you for wearing phalluses on your head?
Yeah,
was the exact phrase that was used, which is funny because on a quasi PG esque related tweet to actually say that
there's a lot of hip gyrating happening. Right. I don't know about the PG esque.
Oh, but I'm saying like phalluses on your head. And I think it was like, well, thank you for wearing phalluses on your head and buying theoretical cereal or something like that.
I not to make this like a transition to this and let's talk about Robin Reigns train. But I honestly would really love to look at the numbers and see how Roman ranks on merch selling compared to guys like the New Day, guys like Kevin Owens.
Right.
You know.
Right.
Well, I honestly would like to see that.
Well, that was interesting. I know several of us here on this show listen to We Watch Wrestling, I think was where I heard this conversation. Because they talked about, I think that's where they talked about how many shirts are in the audience. Regardless of what you hear from the crowd, mm-hmm. there are still a lot of Roman Empire shirts
absolutely.
Out there. You
absolutely.
Know? You know, I don't doubt that at all.
But John Cena's the same way.
Right.
You know.
Especially with kids.
Yeah, exactly. And I don't know. Roman is a little more cross-generational, I feel.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you got dudes rocking it. You know, you got kids rocking it. You got the ladies rocking it because he's so dreamy, you know.
Honestly, I think it's also a design thing too,
sure.
Some people like designs and they're like, that's a pretty cool design on Roman Reigns'
right.
name. And I mean I like Seth Rollins stuff when he was on his own and before the injury and stuff. I'm like, this is a bad guy. I like the way that shirt looks or this, that, and the other. And it's kind of like what Bert and I talked about earlier. It's not almost like a bad guy good guy thing. It's like the fans like it for
the style.
Yeah.
Represent.
I think another part to that as well is that, like, quantity. Like, Kevin Owens has only been in the WWE, like, what? Like, maybe a year and a half?
Yeah.
I would say he's had, like, 10 different t-shirts at least.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Like, New Day's had, like, 5 or 6 now. Like,
yeah.
I think the fact that they're churning out new stuff, I couldn't tell you a Roman Reigns t-shirt other than the one he's wearing currently.
Right.
Like,
there's still, like, some Shield, like, crossover, because that's the gear he had forever, but
it is the spiritual successor, right? I mean he's kind of adapted it and evolved it a little bit, but he's like, well, I love the Shield, and that's still the Shield guy.
Yeah.
You know,
right?
Like to the super super casual fan that doesn't even know all the wrestlers' names,
right?
Which are, let's be honest,
most of them,
they exist.
Yeah,
no, that's
they're
the
not
most
as hardcore
of.
As us.
No. That's the 0.5 that keeps swinging back and forth from week to week in the ratings. You know, or and actually even more so. It's probably fuller to a full point. You know, well, wrestling. You know, like, some people are just tuning in because, oh, it's wrestling.
Yeah,
the Samoan guy and the guys with the unicorn horns and this.
That goes,
you know,
back to casting,
which is me when I'm watching hockey. That guy, the number one of these is Sid Crosby, right? Okay.
And that goes back. That goes back to the casting discussion. Yeah. It's a glorified casting.
Well, actually, we didn't. I don't think we had that here on the show.
We had it offline yet, but that'll go back.
Let's tell you what. Let's have that further discussion.
Okay.
But first of all, I want to give shouts out.
Shouts out.
You know, we don't got. Well, we do have merchandise on the show, but
we do.
We also have sponsors.
Yes.
And while we may not have Skittles, we do have Slice on Broadway. Ooh. Our good friends at Slice on Broadway.
Mm. Excellent pizza.
Supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the finest pepperoni pizza. Now at PNC Park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates. You can check them out at sliceofbroadway.com. Down there at the PNC Park in their new home. As well as the old school first location along the theoretical tracks at the top of the hill here at Beachview. There's construction. And Carnegie, PA, down on Main Street there in the Pittsburgh area. If you're around... And we talked to somebody that was involved in 3D printing from Peacemaker Technologies earlier today on Awesome Cast here on the live stream. And so maybe someday they'll partner with Slice on Broadway, two Pittsburgh originals, and they'll be able to 3D print fax you a slice of pizza so you can get it too. In the meantime, you're going to have to come up here, or you can hit up on Twitter and tell them thank you for supporting the Wrestling Mayhem Show over there. PGH_Slice on Twitter, Slice on Broadway on the Facebook and the Instagram. Let them know the mayhem sent you. All right, let's get into this casting discussion. That you brought this up
and
before
you're
the show.
Me to lead this, okay?
Yeah. But because it's a different way of thinking. Because you put it
coming from me. Huh? Wow, shocker.
Coming from this guy.
Shocker.
But no, what was
because
give me the basis.
Well,
of
a lot
this.
Of the times the IWC, you know, one of the big complaints. And
IWC, the Internet Wrestling.
No, yeah, not
IWC,
international
wrestling
cartel, right? Not that.
No.
Yes, Internet. Yes.
That's why I almost never use that term on the show.
Right.
Because
so.
We are involved with the
IWC
and the IWC, but not the IWC watches.
Right. But but
pain in my ass.
There it is. But one of the big complaints that seems to happen a lot is, oh, so and so gets buried, so and so they're not pushing so and so, and the argument is, you know, well, how come this person isn't champion? How come this person isn't over? How come this person's not the top guy? And I think the arrivals that have come in the past few weeks really speak to the WWE more so than other wrestling groups, more so than, you know, the TNAs or the Globals or the, you know, Ring of Honors or anything, as a casting agency. It's a glorified casting agency. It's a glorified casting call. You know, we don't want the necessarily the top wrestlers, but we want guys that fit the roles we want to have happen. Do we want to have a powerhouse who just fights for the kids and fights for what's right, the hustle, loyalty, respect? Yes, we do. There's John Cena. Do we want to have a tough, brooding Polynesian Samoan to just go in there and kick some ass? Yes, we do. That's Roman Reigns. Three happy black guys. New Day. But seriously, it's casting more so than the performers rising to the top. And one of the things that I like to do when I'm doing independent wrestling, especially promos, when helping people find their character and helping people develop their character, is ask them on independent level, well, why are you here? What's your purpose here at this federation tonight? What's your purpose in this match? And, you know, they'll tell me, but it's all about finding your character. It's different in the WWE because that character has already been ascertained and assigned to them. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where the difference lies, is that, you know, you're not feeling as, you're not the best wrestler in the independent circuit rising to the top of WWE, leveling right. up. You are the best wrestler for the role they need at that given time.
And also, there's a little bit of adaptation, too. Because there's also, yeah, we need a role that's this thing, and then what do you bring to that role?
Right.
You can look
what
at,
can you do that takes it to a different direction?
Right. I mean, look at the pitch, the initial pitch. And this is, I know, an interstitial that pops up on WWE Network from time to time, talking about the Mankind character.
Right.
And kind of right. then what did Foley...
Mason the Mutilator, right?
Mason the Mutilator, right. yeah. Yeah, and then what did he bring to that character, you right. know, that made it Mankind and then it evolved over the years right. and over the years? Undertaker.
Right.
Undertaker.
Or the, you know, the example I just said, the New Day.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
They've talked about the story of the meeting with Vince, and Vince said, oh, you should be preachers. They knew it would die on the vine, but then what they did, they used their personal, you know, charisma, their personal ability to get that over in a way that nobody would have foreseen.
And I don't, you know, we're looking at New Day now, but do you guys remember when New Day first came out?
Yeah, they were dead in the water.
Nobody knew. Yeah. Nobody knew what to do. They're like, okay, all right, okay, this is interesting. And we're just like, well, there goes these guys.
Yeah,
you know,
they're done.
And I don't know what it took. I don't know what they did. You know, other than just them persevering and carrying on when people didn't care.
Power positivity.
Yeah, power positivity, right? And they gave them the chance to move with it. And there it goes.
Absolutely.
Do you think, because I think, and I'm not always the biggest as of late CM Punk fan, but I remember when he was talking about sort of the New Day's rise and stuff like that and when they grew in popularity, about how he mentioned the fact that you can – one of the best things is you can tell, yeah, at that point when they really started to get, you know, get over his faces, the fact that they didn't care almost, but in a good way. Not that they didn't care, but they didn't care, you know, what people were going to think about what they said.
Right.
They
right.
were just going to go out and say right. some stuff and that they thought was funny and, you know, get over, right. you know. I think that's important.
We're going back to, it feels like we're finally going back to the extensions of ourselves.
Right, exactly. Exactly. You know? And that's what's always worked.
That's what I love about like a Kevin Owens.
Right.
Like randomly, I don't know if you guys saw the clip, but I guess during the commercial break on Raw where Lillian announced that they'll be back or whatever for SmackDown or whatever, and Kevin Owens just grabs the microphone from her and says, and I'll be there too, and all the crowd cheers. Like, just in a commercial break. Right. Like, not even right. something that people would see on TV. Like,
right. right. It being a personality, that's the whole point of this game is right. what we're watching, right. you know? And I think there, you know, you mentioned something to this, there was a lot of formula.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, okay, we do this and we do this. So it's the third hour. That means something like this is going to happen. I think a Divas match goes here,
yeah, right.
you know, and it was very paint by numbers. And we, as longtime watchers, to see it. And then the, you know, the guys with the unicorns, Samoan badass guy, I don't even know their names.
Right.
This Hulk Hogan still in this anymore are like, this is the same as I saw last week. I'm going to flip over to Gotham. I don't know. Whatever's on Mondays anymore,
and that leaves the room for the, you know, because it is personality driven. It's entirely personality driven, and you know, and I think, you know, for me as a fan watching it, I'm much more into the personalities. I'm much more into the mic work, the charisma, the whole package than I am the actual in ring product. Mm-hmm. A 20 minute match bores the hell out of me. It does. Even the story they try to tell, you know, that's why I've never been able to really get in the Ring of Honor and all the other things. Entertain me.
Because
I'd argue, and not to knock Ring of Honor, but I don't think they're telling stories like WWE's currently telling.
Right.
No.
With some of the people that have been in Ring of Honor in the past.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Like, I think that's an important aspect of it. I could agree completely with the whole aspect of, like you mentioned, about how wrestlers need to fill a role, so to speak. And I think about when Chachi was actually last on the show, and I remember he brought up a really good point about the fact that everyone on the roster is basically still being listed as independent contractors by WWE. And when they're considered, in the sense of general work speak, when you hire a contractor instead of an employee, you're not hiring them to sort of do this and this and this and this and this. You're hiring them because they're an expert in a certain position that you need filled.
That's right. That's absolutely right. That's a great point.
And I think that's why people like the New Day and Kevin Owens, and to a level even like a Cesaro and guys like that, are starting to shine, because they're allowed more freedom, at least it seems, to kind of try new things and do what they know will get over.
Mm-hmm. I see that. Wheels, what do you think?
I mean, just the way Eamon was talking about that, I was sitting there thinking about, like you said, the Cesaros and Owens and all them. They're getting to be what they were on the indies with a little bit of a WWE touch.
Yep.
And I mean, and that's what the crowd is into. They don't want the cookie cutter WWE wrestler or sports entertainer. They want their indie wrestler. And that's what they're getting with the Owenses and even the Styles now. I mean, and the Bullet Club. Well, not the Bullet Club in the name, but just Gallows and Anderson. And a lot of these guys are being able to be their indie sells with, like I said, that in with the WWE twist.
Right. Gallows is a great example because he was there for what, 3, 4, 5 years, you know, as Festus, and then, you know, the Straight Edge Society, Luke Gallows.
I think this is officially his third character,
right? I mean, it's
technically
fourth if you
two and a half.
Mask Kane.
Fake Kane, yeah, fake Kane, of course.
Fourth,
right?
But to be fair, how many gimmicks did Kane have before Kane?
Oh, exactly.
And actually, yeah. Still,
right?
How many since Kane?
Since Kane, corporate Kane,
corporate Kane, you know,
exactly.
Yeah, you know,
but I mean, yeah, for somebody like him, I mean, this is for Gallus. You know, this is a revival of sorts for him. I mean, you know, who would have thought that after a Straight Edge Society that he would have been back here for any reason? You know, and here he finds his, you know, finds his voice, finds himself in Japan as part of the Bullet Club, and now he's hotter than he's ever been, more over than he's ever been before. He doesn't need anybody else to do it but himself.
Yeah, and he's kind of almost, I mean, obviously it's too early to say, but he's almost made because of that reputation that he's built in Japan.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, to where, you know, look back to when he was in the Straight Edge Society, you know, it could have, if he wasn't able to execute or if he wasn't able to get over enough, they could have easily let him go, and obviously they did. Mm-hmm. So I think now he's in a comfortable place now where, okay, I have this reputation now. I'm over, in a sense.
Right.
Now I can kind of have a bit more.
That doesn't exactly work for people like Tensai, but for Gallows, it's perfect.
But he went and did that thing. Like Tensai went and did that thing
right.
in Japan and made a name for himself over there,
exactly.
Which got their attention to get him back there. And now, I mean, now he's where he's at.
Oh, yeah.
And, now
he's where he belongs. I mean, as a trainer, he's a great mind for the business.
Exactly.
Keep in mind, he also didn't come back as Giant Bernard.
Right.
He came back as
Tensai.
Right.
Yeah, riff on his
but the Giant Bernard is what got their attention. Just like I still think AJ Styles would never have been signed to WWE coming straight from Impact Wrestling.
Of course
not. Or he would have never had the, I'm sorry, impact of...
I see what you did there.
No, I was saying it anyways, and then I realized. you know, coming from a TNA, because it'd be like, well, who's this guy that was in this lesser?
I'm using a pejorative term here, but in their perception, you know, the Japan thing got the TNA stink off him, or the Impact stink off
slash
him.
RLH.
Right. Yes. Slash RLH,
which is something they have a good. I mean, again, one of my favorite nights of wrestling was watching him and Matt Sydal do that match in West Virginia. That was the televised match. That was like a half an hour.
Right.
You know, it was just one of my favorite nights of wrestling. Yeah.
And if you want to sign somebody directly from Ring of Honor and TNA, look where Samoa Joe is.
Right.
And that's exactly, there's your parallel if you don't go to Japan.
And if you're Samoa Joe, you're like, well, I'm in WWE.
Exactly. I mean, you made it.
You know, I think, you know, it's okay not being on the... And that's the whole other question. Like, guys like Finn Balor saying, no, I want to be here.
I want to be here. I want to be right here.
Yeah, I want... Yeah. This is the exciting place to be.
Bailey said that.
To do something. Who said that?
Bailey
said that, too.
In so many words, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they are building a brand down there.
Mm-hmm.
And it just came out that Finn Balor is the longest title holder NXT ever. Which, short history, but significant.
Right.
He's...
Oh, they said developmental history, so they're probably figuring OVW. their what the Florida Championship. Florida Championship.
And I think OVW was a name that was dropped in that conversation as well. So,
yeah, so, I mean, that's pretty good. And it's like, you look at Austin Aries is now down there. You got, like mm-hmm. we said, Joe Balor. A lot of those guys that were in these different places are enjoying, in our eyes, that's the developmental slash feeder to the main roster, but right. they're enjoying it down there almost more than they would being on the main roster.
Right, because if you're just developing that place to be the feeder, then it's going to feel like the feeder. Exactly. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Just like if Superstars is developed to be the thing where we put Raw highlights and a Stardust match, yours is like, why do I tune into this? You know, it's not a destination thing. I know it's not particularly probably meant to. It's meant to be another distribution to get you into. It's another door into the WWE product, right. not a thing for me to catch up what the heck Zack Ryder's been up to.
Exactly.
Right. So, all right, guys, great conversation here. I'm sure we'll be having this for a good while, actually. So let us know what you think about this kind of state of WWE, this NXT influence, this casting idea that Bert has brought up here on the show. I'm really kind of looking forward to see what you guys think of that as well. Hey, we're going to take a look at another story from our 10-year anniversary party at Looking for Group Pittsburgh, our great friends that hosted that party back in January, and we'll be right back with a big question.
I first got into the Mayhem Show because I think it was around 2008. I was getting into like forums and wrestling related stuff on the internet, and I was following another group of people that were doing a sort of podcast sort of thing on TalkShoe, and I had seen sort of the related podcasts and stuff like that, and I listened to an episode of the Mayhem Show, audio only, where DJ Lunchbox and Dr. Remedy rummaged through like some like box in wherever they were podcasting and found like cat pills and a bunch of random like cartoon based stuff, and I had no idea what was happening. They didn't talk about wrestling for the first hour, and then I had to figure out what I was listening to. So I discovered more, and that's kind of how it happened.
Hey guys, it's Wrestling Mayhem Show, and it's time for the big question. And I think I got a good one here. I did not give these guys a heads up. It just kind of sparked in my head. When we're talking about the next generation, right? We're talking about people coming up, replacing, kind of making things fresh. And there's one guy that's been around, not the longest, but the most prominently the longest, I think. And that guy is Michael Cole. Yeah. And we're seeing a lot of new faces. We have Byron Saxton. We got Renee Young hanging out. We have... I keep missing Rollo.
Mario.
Mario Ronaldo. I love him. He's awesome. And I love that they gave him his own kind of like pump up video that I've seen. I think on the network, was it? Where there was like everybody talking to him from This Week in Wrestling.
Right.
This Week in WWE. So out of all these kind of names and faces coming through, who do you think becomes that next Michael Cole? Out of all those, not to mention Corey Graves, Tom Phillips.
Oh, right.
You know, there's a lot. There's a lot of names out there. It really, voice talent has been freshened up a lot. There's even a secondary Lillian Garcia.
Yeah, there's a second wave there, and I think that's. Yeah. I mean, it's ripe for the taking, and right now, again, you talk about roles.
Yeah.
You know, Michael Cole. You know, we all take him or leave him in terms of commentary. But again, for the exact role that the WWE needs, mm-hmm. he is the perfect guy for it, and I think that's because it's not you know JR part two. He's not JR.
No,
but for what
he's less of a character.
But for what the WWE needs, he is the he's the straight man. He's the traffic director. Everybody else bounces off him. The in ring action bounces off him. JBL bounces. Saxton bounces. It's all about he keeps everything centered. Mm-hmm. You know, as a fan, you have a certain kind of criticism. Oh man, he keeps burning those Twitter feeds, and then before that was Tout, right? He keeps burning mm-hmm. Tout, but
he's the hype.
But
man. He is the hype man. He's a pro wrestling hype man.
He's
when
the hype
in that
man. He's the one who tells stories, and he's the one who literally brings the action to you. If someone, you know, I'm watching, you know, I watch every week, of course, and I know what's going on and I follow what's going on and I'm knee deep in social media about it and all the other things. But if someone walks up next to me, sits down next to me, never seen Raw before, he's the guy that's talking to that person.
Michael Cole is, you know, comic books have a lot of times, especially in Marvel comic books, that first page is completely dedicated to this is what's been happening. This is who's important in this. You have a primer before picking up that issue instead of like a lot of times they do it kind of in the back dialogue and stuff like that. Right.
Explain everything.
Because there's that philosophy of that every comic could be somebody's first comic.
Right, exactly.
Every episode of Raw could be the first somebody's, or the first back or the first seeing this guy. And he's the one that says, I mean, that's why you hear the same lines over and over again. Right. So they get that
and
out.
And it's not, obviously, I'm not comparing, you know, this to Raw, but, you know, whenever I do the commentary for RWA or the VOW match, whatever, I will, you know, for whatever audience watches it on DVD or stream, wherever, I'll pretend in my head that somebody's watching that for the first time. And I'm always, you know, I'm always cognizant of that. Even doing ring announcing or something like that, you give me that look. But even ring announcing that somebody there in the RWA audience is watching this for the first time.
And you play
to that person because everybody else is going to be there next month.
The look was me thinking, explaining it as if you're explaining it to your grandmother.
That's perfect. That's a perfect analogy. Yeah. That really is.
I think of that with technology and kind of teaching a little bit too. Like you gotta be like you gotta be the most simplest like anybody can understand this.
Right, and sometimes they take it to extremes. I think the one time I noted to nobody in particular because I was watching by myself, but it was still an oh come on.
No, you had your dog.
Tobias was watching next to me, and one of the cats was too. But you know, the oh come on moment was, I think it was in November or December. And Saxton said something to the effect of, well, the League of Nations is one of those dominant factions in WWE history. And they'd been together for like 2 weeks. You know, but telling stories, driving the point home, getting it over. But if somebody was watching next to me, they'll think, oh, wow, these League of Nations have been one of the most dominant factions in WWE history. They cater to the short memories, but it works for them because it gets their talking points across. And I think every time you see an interview with Michael Cole in the real world, not the WWE canon, but in the real world, and that's one of the things that comes up. Oh, well, you say this and you beat everything up. He does a masterful job of explaining what exactly goes on with Michael Cole during those shows. The fact that he has to be the traffic cop with Vince and Hunter and everybody else yelling in his head at the same time. He's got 9 different directives at the minimum every second of the show, and you're on live television doing that.
And get the sponsor, and mention this, and
plug
the Twitter, and do this, and this thing is coming up on the network.
And I think for anybody who ever doubted Michael Cole's ability, and anybody who ever, bashed him or whatever, they got a wake-up call the show that Lawler had his heart attack. And what he could do, and because, I mean, he is a broadcast journalist, and you know, he's from Syracuse University, my alma mater.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he is a broadcast journalist first and foremost, and he has that experience in him to be live with the action. And for that position, like him or hate him, he is the perfect person in that role. And I don't see him leaving anytime soon.
So who replaces him?
Who replaces him if
that comes to pass?
I you mentioned it, but I hope Mara and all that. Like I think, obviously.
Right.
In that transition that we kind of mentioned in how the style of WWE's main roster seems to be going, I think he fits that perfectly. I think he has the potential, obviously. I mean, because he's done sports casting before. I think he has the potential to be a great narrator and a great sort of voice for the entire organization.
Right.
I do think that he has... And it's not really his fault. I think it's sometimes the fault of the way his announce partners kind of react to him. But he kind of falls into that, sometimes into, you know, that period where Matt Stryker was doing a lot of commentary and he would make these references and people would think that he was kind of like being too wordy and they would always give him crap for that, basically.
I really liked Matt Stryker, by the way. I'm going to go to record and say that.
I loved his commentary at WWE.
He's one of those, like, he gets excited because he's genuinely excited about it and it's infectious.
Exactly.
It makes me excited.
Yeah.
I didn't mean to cut you off, Eamon, but I just want to make that point clear.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's just that a lot of his critics say, like, he talked over people's heads and stuff like that. And yeah, I guess that can be argued, but I think it's nice to have somebody that can deliver a level of emotion, which I'm not going to be the guy that like likes Michael Cole, but I do think that that's what he lacks at times. And I think that's the one thing people loved about someone like a JR isn't just because he was this character, he was had this Southern accent and whatever. It was that he made you feel emotions through it, what he was saying. Like, and I think that's so important to not just, you know, wrestling matches even, but the overall show. If you can make somebody feel something, that's so powerful. And and I think Mauro is somebody that has that potential in him.
I agree with that.
Honestly, yeah, I agree with that whole statement of, I mean, if you think of like the people like Bert, when you were doing commentary, when Church was gone, you were with Doc.
Right.
That was a different type of chemistry together.
Yeah.
But I mean, when you have Doc and Church together, it's like the Michael Cole and Bobby Heenan, well, Bobby Heenan and Gorilla Monsoon type thing with them. So that's just like one of those crazy moments of, I like that chemistry. And with having three, Eamon said it perfectly, or I forget if it was a Hubert that said that it was.
I blame our promoter for ruining that vibe by not having me on commentary anymore, but I'm just saying.
You have a guest there. Have you relayed the big question to him, by the way? Does he have an answer that he'd like to share? Since we're getting these cameos on the video, like, I mean, you might as well chime in while we're at it.
His opinions.
Let me ask that question to him then, since it's a big question. How was that big question again, Sorg?
Who would you see replace Michael Cole?
Okay, who would you see replacing Michael Cole in the like on commentary, like the newer type people of in the roles? Because I know you watch a little bit of Raw.
Well, I hate it.
Because it's not RWA.
I mean, could you see, like, say Triple H or Vince came to RWA and said, I want Doc or Church. Could you see them taking any company? Yes.
RWA promoter Dr. Feelbad, by the way, is in the background.
You can be a long-winded answer that you're good for. I mean, hey, I don't know.
Tell me what you think about that.
He's going to think about it, he said.
It's on the spot. He doesn't understand the concept. Does he listen to this show? No, he doesn't.
He'll answer next month.
He'll answer next month.
Next month. The West Newton Gymnasium.
The West Newton Gymnasium.
You'll answer that question next month at RWA.
That's right. If you want to hear the answer, you got to be there.
Oh, he just said not Burt LeGrand.
Oh.
Because that means I leave him, and that means he needs me, and he doesn't want to lose that, so he does not want me to be in the WWE.
We'll believe that one, yeah.
Right.
It's called perception.
What about you, Burt? Who would you see replacing?
I think Mario would be a good fit for the hearing now. In terms of the voices we know and in terms of the voices we trust, I think he'd be a good one, like Eamon said. I mean, he's good with the hype. He's good with just getting people involved. And, you know, he definitely brings sort of a real sports vibe to it. I know that's sort of, you know, it's counter to the sports entertainment vibe, but it's also the, you know, it's part of the overall presentation. If the SmackDown and the Raw are the shows that, yes, they're the ones where you actually physically see the action, then you may as well have a guy who can treat it like action itself. And if you have a guy that can call it and get into the emotion of the match, I think he's a great guy for it. I think he's a great voice for it. And, you know, and that's where, you know, the JBL and the Saxons come in and just sort of augment everything. I think it's a good fit all the way around. Or in SmackDown's case, it's Lawler, you know.
Right, and for me, Mauro, he just kind of makes sense, and I can see the rest of them kind of filling in around that. Like maybe the Tom Phillips Corey Graves combination can move up to SmackDown, because Lawler's not going to be around forever. Either.
Don't forget Rich Brennan NXT. He's a good next man up kind of thing for that straight man vibe that can, you know, go both ways.
Yeah, certainly. And from the chat, one comment from Garza, he says, if it's not Mauro, then something went completely wrong. So as long as Mauro isn't like smoking up with Adam Rose and Victor from the Ascension, I think he'll be okay. You know, that kind of thing. So, Mauro makes SmackDown washable. SmackDown's been washable with matches for a while.
I've enjoyed SmackDown
far more than Raw for the longer time than Raw.
It won't be destination, I mean, for me, but if it's on, I'll watch it.
Yeah.
I think watchable, yes, it's still not necessary. You know?
Right. No, right. Absolutely not. Right. I'm not sad if I miss it, but it's
nice for it to be there.
Yeah, right. You're like, huh. That was a good SmackDown. You know, right. I got to just roll out of bed on a Saturday, queue up my Hulu, and watch an hour and a half of SmackDown.
Right. It's getting away from the Raw part two. I think that's the beauty of it.
But it's also the refresher was also John Cena's not all over the top of this thing.
Right.
The usual people aren't all over. The main event of that was Kevin Owens versus Dean Ambrose before we marked out at it being the main event of Raw.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I mean, I think, and you would have a storyline around that instead of John Cena, whoever, what authority, whatever.
Right.
Right. It's the B show that is, you know, like when Saturday main event?
WCW Saturday Night.
Saturday Night, like when that was still the watcher show and watchable show and not the super jobber show that where we just talk about Nitro all night, you know, like that kind of thing, you know. I think it's in the best spot it's been in years. I think it's in the best spot it's been since the brand split
SmackDown 6.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, exactly. So all right, from there, we had. Did everybody answer the big question? I think we got that through for everybody, except for.
Yeah, I got an answer from him.
Okay.
He said Wendy Bell.
She's available.
Wendy Bell.
Yeah.
Pittsburgh Strong. Anyways, nope. Sorry, Eamon. We'll explain to that to you afterwards.
Long story.
It's not.
Yeah, okay.
We're not getting into it on the show.
No.
You guys can tweet it, but anyways, so there was a shocking statement when we were off air.
That's right.
Bert is bringing the controversy to the show
live or taped or whatever you choose to watch it, dear viewer.
To reiterate,
okay,
what you had to say.
I actually mentioned this to you in the notes that I sent you a few weeks ago when I was watching NXT Takeover Dallas before WrestleMania. And I saw the card, and it was a great card, great show.
Mm-hmm.
I saw a match between two guys I just don't get. And in terms of character, in terms of motivations, it's two guys I just don't get. And it was also hailed by many as the match of the night, if not match of the year so far, 4 months into the year. That's Zayn and Nakamura. What are you waving at?
I'm trying to wave at somebody on the other end of the internet.
Oh.
Don't worry about me. Your thing.
All through the tubes. But Zayn and Nakamura, all right. They're going to come after me, aren't they?
No, but, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. What are you doing?
Waving and pointing.
Tell the people what you're doing. But don't worry Zayn about what I'm
Zayn
doing.
Zayn and Nakamura,
I'm trying to get somebody's attention.
Are two people I just don't get. I don't understand. I watch Nakamura. I see, he's the most charismatic person in ages.
Mm-hmm.
I just don't see it. I absolutely don't see it. I see he's flashy, but I don't get his character. I don't get his motivation. I don't get how he, you know, I don't get what he's fighting for. I don't get what. Same thing with Zayn, but to a lesser extent. I mean, Zayn, I know, is the plucky baby face always, and I just don't get the. How do you expect to attain the top prize in the WWE vibe from him? In terms of why are you here? Like I mentioned earlier, in terms of like working with indie guys and promos, why are you here? What's your motivation in tonight's match?
I would love to hear your conversation with Nakamura over that.
Oh, yeah. No, I agree. Mean, I agree.
That should be a podcast.
Yes, it should be a podcast. Yes.
Bert tries to understand Nakamura.
That's you know? Right. That's
That'd
right.
be as great as a promoter I knew trying to understand Kaiju Big Battle and talking to those promoters. But in terms of,
do I get the appeal? I'm sure I do, but it's I personally,
you really only have one for me. You only really have one moment of oppression from him.
It's not for me. Right. It wasn't okay. for me. I saw it and like.
And you have never seen any of his New Japan stuff.
I didn't, and almost purposefully so. And I watched it afterward. Right, I watched it, but it's the same. I mean, I don't. It's not for me.
Okay,
you know, my favorite match on the card was the tag match with American Alpha,
which is great.
I think that was an incredible match. I think that was just an incredible match. Two incredible athletes, emotion. I felt it. They wanted to win the prize. They won the prize. They showed the emotion. That was my favorite match of the night by far.
That was a story. And that was a great story. The Nakamura was a...
Exhibition.
It was an exhibition.
It was an exhibition of his talents.
It was an exhibition and a pretext. Right. Like, everybody there has seen or clips or whatever Nakamura in New Japan.
And do you follow NXT like pretty regularly, I would say?
Oh, yeah.
Like the weekly show?
Yeah.
Okay. I think I don't know. I can understand, like, in the sense of like his character is very like his character in the sense of like he has a lot of swagger, like not to find like a better word in the sense. Right. And I think like you see that a lot with Japanese strong style wrestlers.
Right.
But he's taken it kind of into a different realm where he feels like he's almost like a rock star in a sense. Mm-hmm. And I guess that's the best way I could personally describe his character. You not understanding Sami Zayn, I think, is very interesting about. Personally, I think I liked El Generico, but to me, Sami Zayn's his most complex work, you know, in the sense that it's himself. And I love the mentality of, you know, plucky young baby face, but also a guy who's been working, hard to be taken seriously by people.
Yeah, I think he's being positioned as the new Daniel Bryan because they had
absolutely
they had seen the Daniel Bryan thing coming for a few years now in terms of just I'd say ever since Mania 30, the end was pretty much near for Daniel Bryan after he got hurt pretty much immediately after that, and it's like they had to have planned around that. They had to have gotten say, okay, we got to fast track this guy now to be that guy, and it's one of those things where. Do I see him, and we had this test with Ambrose at Mania. Do I see a Nakamura beating a Brock Lesnar conceivably, believably? Do I see a Sami Zayn?
And I don't think he did in New Japan.
No, but so. do I see a Sami Zayn beating a Brock Lesnar if Brock Lesnar was heavyweight champion? Do I see it believably?
No.
It really stretches the realm of imagination.
I could see him being a Roman Reigns.
Yeah, I could see that.
Like if build properly. Like Brock Lesnar obviously has been created into such a level where you need someone special to beat him. Me, as far as people currently in WWE right now, there's only two people who I could see that I could legitimately buy as of now that could beat Brock Lesnar. One is Nakamura, just from his the stuff that he's done in New Japan. The other is Samoa Joe. I think both of those guys have that have gotten built in a way. To where, and obviously Nakamura is fresh, but have been built in a way where I could conceivably see them taking down the top monster.
And that's a question too, because like Nakamura still needs to be sold to somebody like you who has
clearly.
Like in what is he going to be in WWE? Obviously he's going to be pretty much like what he was, but what is that from here? I mean, is the guy going to cut some great promos? I don't know if that's going to work well.
It won't.
What happens? Or they just let him come out, kick ass, and walk away?
It's
like a Baron Corbin,
I like what they've done with Corbin. I mean, I think, and he's improved in the ring. And I think they present him very well as a lone wolf kind of guy. I mean, I like the way they've presented him.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, maybe I need some more time with Nakamura. Maybe I do, and I'll be the first one to admit that. I'm more than willing to give people the talent the benefit of the doubt in that regard.
I want to soothe your thoughts. I got a better way to put that. But from the chat room, Garza, our friend down El Paso, he says he wasn't a big fan of Zayn versus Nakamura, but that's because he's an indie hipster and will bow down to Will Ospreay. And then they're discussing Matt once it says he needs to get off the skinny Brits and get with some strong style. So there's also a style preference too, because if you watch Wrestle Kingdom, there's a lot of very different styles there that we don't see here in the States, like this strong style
thing. Right, right.
And really, I can't think of anybody else that would be a proper representative, but this is our introduction to Strong Style.
Oh, it is.
As has flourished in Japan.
It is.
So there's that too. So there's going to be a little bit of a curve that, and I think there's some people that saw it like, oh, this is my shit right here. Right. When it comes to that, right. Just like they see Ring of Honor, like that's the kind of thing. Or they see Skinny Brits like Will Ospreay and say, that's my shit right there. Right?
But I think it also is a personal preference too. Like I said, at the outset of the show, if not minutes before that, you know, I'm a mic work guy. I'm a character guy. I'm a guy, and that's just who I've always been. I've always been the guy behind the guys who go on the stick, the guys who can tell physically, verbally tell me a story, and that's what I've always been behind.
If Nakamura translates his charisma, in WWE, I think it'll be a pretty good, you know, charisma like that. Like that face right there, that was back there.
Jesus,
sorry. charisma, you know, that's definitely, you know.
And I agree with you completely. I think that's the thing I like about. I mean, I liked, like I said, I liked El Generico when using Ring of Honor, but I really love Sami Zayn more now. I wasn't necessarily even the big. I didn't dislike him, but I wasn't the biggest Kevin Owens fan in Ring of Honor. Kevin Steen fan in Ring of Honor. Yeah. Now the stuff he's doing as Kevin Owens, I think is amazing. Mm-hmm. I think AJ Styles, for example, is a great wrestler, but other than he was a part of Bullet Club and that's the story they're going for right now, he doesn't really have like a character, right, on you. And I agree. I want a mix of great wrestling and great character. Daniel Bryan was considered to be so amazing, not just because he put on amazing matches, but because he had that connection with the fans. And I think that is equally as important, if not more important.
Right? Oh, right.
Right. Right.
And I can definitely see your points on Nakamura and Zayn. All I know, like, and obviously it's because of my past watching Nakamura, but like, Nakamura had his match this week against like Ty Dillinger.
Right.
And like that music hit, and I literally had chills. Like I felt my body like rushed with
chills. But whoa, hey, you better get that checked out. But little things with Nakamura, like I remember, there's the tweet from when that happened WrestleMania weekend from Ty Jones. He's like, you know, like you can't be on a 10, and Nakamura just responds, "I'm 11."
Right.
Like that. I think that's. And again, I don't know how that's going to translate on a microphone or anything. I don't know how great his English is. Last I knew, he has a translator helping him out.
Yeah, and that's fine. And that might add to his mistake, which
is Funaki, by the way. You know, but then again, if Funaki just comes out and translates for him, I think that would definitely help his character.
Right. and on the spectrum of mic work and get guys over, you know, I'm instantly, and I always was in NXT too, Enzo and Cass.
Yeah.
Best non-New Day act right now.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because people get it. They got into it. They were brought along perfectly.
We're going on a different tangent here, but
you can't teach that. But the one thing I'm surprised they have not done yet. Mm-hmm. Every time on WWE television so far, they have cut to the crowd when they do the "You can't teach that." Every single time, you don't actually see Enzo do that.
Yeah.
So you pick up on the crowd's thing, but not once have they showed Enzo doing "You can't teach that." So it's almost like the primer at home. You have to trust that the crowd knows that.
Yeah.
Which is good, because I think part of their vibe, and they say that every time in commentary, oh, they're the most popular NXT team, you know, team in NXT history. Mm-hmm. And showing the crowd react to that is a good, you know, visual cue.
As a casual.
The other thing is like when Cass does the whole soft thing, like he used to actually say it, and now he'll just point the microphone up to them and the whole crowd will say it for him. It reminds me of like when The Rock was starting to get popular and he would do those backstage pre-tape promos where he would do the millions and millions, and he has to trust that crowd's going to say it.
Oh, yeah.
And isn't that an interesting thing? Because now, like, WWE kind of, when you have something like The Rock or these guys now, and I feel like we haven't had this in years to this effect.
It is.
But you have this inclusive thing. Like, you're, again, we're going back to that, you know, who's that Samoan guy watcher.
Right.
And be like, wow, look at 20,000 people saying along with this one guy.
Right.
Like, there's this inclusive thing. And now you want to be part of that group. And the fact that, like, Enzo and Cass did that and had that.
Mm-hmm.
Their first night walking out is incredible.
Well, you already knew. I mean, that's the thing. I was going back and forth with somebody before that, and like weeks ago, like 4 or 5 weeks ago, And I'm thinking, I really like these guys in NXT. And the only time to credibly debut them is the night after Mania. Mm-hmm. Because you have an inherent audience of at least half the guys and half the people in that crowd know their shtick.
We're there already. Friday.
Right.
We're there Friday to watch
that. Exactly. or that too. But they weren't even on the card Friday.
I feel like they weren't. No, what,
they weren't on TakeOver.
They weren't even on pre-show or anything.
I don't think. No.
They've got a match with American Alpha next week. And I think that's their last.
But they weren't on TakeOver. No.
No, not on TakeOver. But still, but that crowd would have.
Yeah.
Because I felt like they just transposed that entire crowd from Friday and put them on Monday.
Well, that one Saturday.
But even then. I was going to say, even then, they had them in Toronto.
Yeah.
In the Roadblock, which was basically a glorified house
show. Right, Roadblock, right, exactly. Yeah. They had that thing on Roadblock, and they were over there, too, because people know them. And I think not only is it a great dynamic, with Enzo and Cass now, but you also have in your back pocket a year and a half, 2 years from now, pull the trigger on probably one of the best heel turns you're ever going to see when Cass is, says enough.
Oh, I hope not.
You hope not. But when they do,
I hope not.
Well, when they do, oh God, he's gonna be such a heel.
Yeah, who says that?
Wow.
And you can't teach that.
You can't book that, ladies and gentlemen. This has been fantastic. But I want to learn. I want to find out. Wait. First of all, Wheels, I know you've been occupied there. You have somebody looking over your shoulder.
I killed him. He's gone.
I just, do you or other wrestling promoters that happen to be on the premises happen to have any thoughts on Nakamura or whatever the hell else we were talking about?
Well, he said, like I said, he said Wendy Bell. And I mean, he was serious about that. No, and
we're not talking about Wendy Bell.
Being commentary would be good. Hey, come on. She's quirky. She's smart. She's edgy,
I will obviously. Counter that last part.
Yeah.
But Nakamura.
Yeah, please let's talk about Nakamura.
I don't think he's caught Nakamura, so to answer that. But me, I mean, I like Nakamura. He's not a bad wrestler.
For commentary?
So.
Oh, for
Nakamura on commentary. No, oh, no.
Yeah, I want to see him on commentary so I can go, what?
Awesome.
But other than that, I think Nakamura is a great talent and everything. And I just said it earlier just to you guys and Derek just now that, honestly, I think Triple H, if he's letting these guys loose with this, with them being able to have their own characters, and because I've enjoyed past 3 weeks of Raw, but obviously somehow the ratings aren't showing that, though. So I don't know.
Oh, they're not. That's unfortunate.
Yeah.
But you can't deny
that
the crowd.
No.
You can't deny and that's what the I just said to him. I was like, honestly, I think what it is a lot of people that are watching it on TV would rather be there live experiencing that because we've seen it, me, you, Bert, Eamon, all of us, live crowds really matter.
Right.
I think also the ratings don't necessarily even detail how long they're sticking around.
Right.
Like the length in which they'll watch Raw for, I guess, so to speak. I would be more interested to see that compared to ones from, like, say, a month, 2 months ago.
And like previous Raws after Mania, though, I mean, we're back to the hardcore fans. Mm-hmm. Because think about Mania. Think about Mania and what happened and where we're at now.
Yeah.
Title match, main event. Roman Reigns, Triple H. One of them is not wrestling anymore. Undertaker, Rick Mann. Both of them aren't wrestling anymore. One's still on TV, but they're not wrestling.
Right.
Ambrose, Lesnar. Lesnar's out right now. Now you push the reset button again with new people. And, Taker, Triple H, Lesnar, three people that everybody knows. And people, some people, the casual fan knows, the casual fan wants to see. Not on TV anymore.
Yeah.
Period.
Yeah. Right.
So, we're back to... Okay, now we're back to the hardcore fans. These are the guys that everybody
It's a little bit like just like primetime TV. You're as good as your lead-in.
Right.
Everybody got mad.
Honestly, I think what Derek even said, and I agree, is cut the 3 hours back to two, and I think you might have a little bit better viewership.
Well, to be fair,
sponsorship ad revenue.
Yeah,
money talks.
That's where it's at there, and they're not interested in you're going to tune in for 3 hours anyways.
Right.
If you're doing a Wrestling Mayhem show.
I never say at 10 o'clock, oh, I'm done. I can't watch anymore after 2 hours.
Right.
Because I'm the fan that, you know, watches 3 hours.
I'm the guy that takes cat naps during the commercial breaks and set an alarm for 3 minutes so I can get back up and watch more. You know what I mean?
I did fall asleep, speaking of cat naps. I did fall asleep during Triple H Roman Reigns.
Oh, no.
I did. I caught myself falling asleep twice.
That was a very long night.
That was a very long night. 7 hours of wrestling. That's a lot.
It's a little bit much.
I was surprised that I made it through 7 hours of WrestleMania. I was just like shocked.
Yeah.
Because I looked at the time like, wow, that actually went that fast and it was that long.
I felt worse because I had people at the house. I fell asleep as the host.
Really? Oh, sorry. Guys.
You all right, dude?
Because there's no warning. There's no warning. That, like, hell, main event's going to be at 11:15.
Yeah. And 28 minutes long.
And 28. Wow.
As what's his face Austin said to, or yesterday or today, that, you know, he commented about how long the mania was.
Wow.
Anyways, it was a celebration. Got to entertain those 100,000 people.
That's right.
Forever. Was it then, now, forever for WWE's catch line?
Right.
They didn't realize how far they're going to stretch that title. Guys, what'd you learn from wrestling this week?
What did I learn from wrestling? I learned that even though a rope may break, that crowd don't give a damn.
Nope. I can't wait to edit this thing, by the way. RWA Spring Fling. Look for it soon on IndieWrestling.us.
Hashtag RWA San Francisco. SF.
But as if.
SF.
Oh,
SF. Made it.
As if.
You made it.
As if.
Oh, like, well, that's as a, if. That was a weird character turn.
But I learned that, well, go to me. I learned that I learned the value of improvisation, the value of having fun in wrestling from the live event at RWA. I don't think I've had more fun at a single event that I had this past Saturday. And that, because of all things happening, that's what makes wrestling magical for me. It's that whole sequence of just improv, and that's what drew me to for the past 31 years I've been watching. Stuff that you never can predict what's going to happen. You can book it.
Mm-hmm.
You can predetermine it, but you can never predict it. And I think that's Saturday was proof of that.
You know, it's like the fun part of Saturday Night Live is it is
live. Yes.
Right. Anything can happen. People forget their lines.
Exactly.
And same with theater and same with pro wrestling.
Right. Like
a lot of the same aspects there.
Exactly.
And I think that's what, you know, and we get excited when we're like, oh, that wasn't supposed to happen.
Right.
Like, we want to see the catches and we want to see the breaks. Right. We want to see that kind of stuff. Not the rope breaks.
Right. No, not the rope breaks. That was unfortunate. That was unfortunate. But
Eamon, what'd you learn?
I learned from wrestling this week that if you ever get that moment where you feel like, you know, there's nothing that can happen that's worse, that you're at the complete bottom, don't worry. Because your company could get bought by Nazi sympathizers.
That's right.
Explain, please.
Oh, do I need to?
Yes, you do, because I barely know this story. I was apparently at the offices of Nazi sympathizers this weekend. So I took a picture in front of I took the memeable picture in front of TNA's offices in Nashville on Wednesday.
The rumors were swirling that TNA was Panda Energy didn't have TNA any longer, mm-hmm. And that they were selling the company to whatever the top buyer was. They actually were sold, apparently, according to reports, to the top heads of production right now for TNA, which are the Harris brothers. Yes, Sorg, those Harris brothers.
Really?
Like Don and Ron Harris.
Okay, thank you.
Like DOA.
Okay.
Like Creative Control from WCW.
Yes.
Okay.
The Blue Brothers. We can go on.
We can go on and on.
Right.
They apparently own TNA now. They own TNA.
Wow.
And I say that they were Nazi sympathizers because immediately I saw a thing of someone posted like, apparently one of them's got like a swastika tattoo or something.
I knew that. I didn't know the link between them buying TNA, but I knew one of them did have that you know on them. But
yeah.
That's funny. Oh wow.
So yeah.
So, wow.
Ain't wrestling fun?
Ain't wrestling fun? Hey, I learned. Jeez.
Your turn.
You know what I learned? I learned. I dropped the name Jerry Lawler in just casual conversation in the in Nashville, and nobody, like, they know exactly who Jerry Lawler is. Like, it's not. It's like saying Hulk Hogan.
Sure.
Like down there.
Sure.
Because it was actually, I was at the Dukes of Hazzard Hall of Fame. Museum. I paid the $5 and I got a picture in the General Lee because nice. I grew up on the damn Dukes of Hazzard. I don't. That's care. Right.
Do they have the shrine to Coy and Vance?
Who?
Coy and Vance.
Coy and Vance. It's called Cooters.
What? No, Coy and Vance. The year that Bo and Luke held out in real life and they had to put Coy and Vance in as the substitute Bo and Luke Duke?
No, I didn't see anything about that.
What?
Also not brushed up on my Duke history. I mean, I grew up on it, but then I've really detached ever since, right. To be quite honest.
Right.
So, but
Coy and Vance were great. They expected people to buy them as the Bo and Luke Duke. They were like, wow. The GoBots of the... of the Duke boys.
Did they replace Daisy?
No, I don't think they did.
This is another podcast. Yeah. This is a whole other podcast.
She'd have a contract issue, apparently.
But we were talking about, because I saw like there was a Duke Fest or something, and there were like hundreds of General Lees and everything, right? And I'm like, yo, how many of these are there? I saw the picture in there, and I mentioned about, because I had recently listened to a Jerry Lawler interview on one of those podcasts where he talks about how he got his Batmobile.
Right.
And I said, yeah, there was a guy that was making them, and that's how Jerry Lawler got his or something. I know that's not the complete story, but and then, you know, didn't even bat an eye, you know? Like, yeah, I know Jerry Lawler's. You know, and that was like a weird, cool moment.
Mm-hmm.
And like, you know, I would hesitate to say, yeah, Jerry Lawler, blah blah blah. But it slipped out and I was in the right place and I was amongst the right people. And that was just kind of a really cool, interesting moment for me. On my trip this last week. So there you go. Also, completely missed wrestling. The wrestling. Oh, I talked about it at the beginning. I can't remember if it was on air or off air. I talked about that. But I don't know. Didn't need to see Jeff Jarrett again. But anyways, from the Facebook, there it is. Hello. We had from Jen Carlins, Dean Ambrose, really, really... loves plants, particularly that plant.
He does, yeah.
That is like,
he really likes that plant.
That is my favorite thread of the Ambrose Asylum. Hey, wait, Shane, hold this, please. Chris LaRusso, friend of the show, who actually his interview will be airing on this week's Indie Mayhem show shortly after his match with Tatanka.
Oh, yes.
So that was a pretty cool conversation he had. We all can get along, he says. After some technical difficulties at the Ring of Honor dojo, the ROH tryout camp moved to Bristol, PA, to the world-famous Monster Factory. The Monster Factory was more than accommodating and was able to put up the entire camp on less than 12 hours' notice.
Wow.
Amazing to see two schools work together for the benefits of the wrestling world as a whole. Shout-outs to Danny Cage of the MF Monster Factory and Hunter Johnson of ROH for being great coaches and leaders and setting an example for all to follow. That's awesome. Mad Mike also learned that I'm pretty sure Barbie made a Sasha Banks doll. There's a picture here over on the Facebook. I am not able to pull up, but yes, it looks a lot like Sasha Banks. Alex Carrs learned that WWE Creative had no idea how they want the Golden Truth angle to be resolved. I don't know. It's just kind of there.
the result of them. Not knowing how to resolve it. Let's just add Fandango.
Yeah. Sure. It works.
Let's get weird. And also, Bobby FJ Town learned that he wants to find a third Bella that was locked in the attic of their childhood home.
Oh, only that's for, an inside
only
joke
for it to come out and total Bellas. Her name is Zoop Bella, and she resembles Rachel Dratch's character from SNL with the baby arm coming out of her head, and there's a link to that. Yeah, so total Bellas is a thing?
Sure.
I guess so.
Whatever.
When I read that, I was like, oh, that's how they're going to spin the show because of them dropping the Divas moniker.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just going to make it about the Bellas, which is fine. I mean, it's totally cool. But apparently they're still doing Total Divas.
Right.
It's just they have a separate side show now.
This is the third hour of Raw equivalent of Total Divas.
Yeah, right.
This is NXT Total Divas.
This is Total Divas Legends House.
Yeah, right. Oh, right. God. Alumni.
It is. Because, I mean, these are all the people that aren't doing anything. Like, right. Listen, wait a minute.
Total Bellas kind of intrigues me, just from the promotional photo alone. It's obviously Bree and Nikki and their respective boyfriends.
Who happened to be Daniel Bryan and John freaking Cena?
Yeah.
Also, their mother and her husband, John Laurinaitis.
Yeah, right.
All about people power. Like, I hope they live in a house together. Picture.
That thing is what it is.
And the other one is her brother and his brother's wife, who from the promotional photo I thought was a third Bella. Like, there was a third Bella that we don't know about.
You know what? I can't get the picture in high enough resolution to determine that she's a real person.
It looks like a third Bella.
There was a third Bella back and to the left. Like, literally, on next staircase.
Right.
Jeez. On that note, thank you so much, everybody. I don't think anybody learned anything on the channel. Yes, Matt Carlin's just learned that top-rated Australian wrestlers on cagematch.net is Peyton Royce. Been popping up. Garza will now tell us how great she is. There was a conversation about why Brit wrestling is so hot right now, and where's the next thing coming from Australia? You had to be there. Live at SorgatronMedia.com every Tuesday night about 8 p.m. Eastern time, and till whenever the hell we damn well please, done. Apparently. Thank you so much for joining us. And of course, WrestlingMayhemShow.com for all the stuff. Subscribe to the show. Patreon.com/WrestlingMayhemShow, at Mayhem Show on Twitter, Wrestling Mayhem Show on the Facebook and Facebook group. A lot of great conversation, including a lot of those what we learned from wrestling that I shared this evening. So a lot of good stuff. Thank you so much. Old school Burt LeGrand.
Pleasure as always.
Thank you for coming back.
This is great.
Yes.
I enjoy it. Have me on again.
Is that a threat?
That's a threat.
Oh, man.
I have a microphone on RWA show, so I can just, call
it
you
is
out.
True. Yeah.
Not next month, though.
Stop throwing Sorgatron Media under the bus, by the way.
What are you talking
You're
about?
You're healing me out. I thought we were letting people film. You said don't film.
You can ask Dobbers. You can ask Missy. I softened my stance last show.
Good. I did. Good. I did. Stop. We want them to buy the DVDs. Yes. Stop making us look bad.
The bin of DVDs. There was a note there. I was told to promote the bin of DVDs at the last show. And it was a stack of DVDs on the table, the in the paper sleeves. No bin. So it was a theoretical bin of DVDs.
All right, we're gonna have to work with our marketing department, apparently. I have the March DVDs on my desk upstairs. Ooh, they're still there. They were ready to go.
March to victory.
There it is. Just sitting on my desk.
Shame on you, Sorg.
I just me.
I don't know. I just thought I'd blame you.
Sure, he's here.
Hot Wheels blaming the way over at RWA live.com. Hot Wheels RWA sound guy to the stars, the Renegade Wrestling Alliance, and of course the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling.
Yes. Sorry.
Good friend.
Wow, he's not talking now.
Good friend.
I don't know what to say.
He's trolling you.
Good friend.
Inspire Pro Wrestling. Yes. We got a show this weekend. Go do it. It'll be fun. It's in Austin, Texas. Check us out.
I'm sure we'll talk about it more on Indie Mayhem Show later on. So go check it out. That would be episode 116. If you want to check that out, with Booker T, Chris Russo, and RJ City talking about Donald Trump and potatoes. If that doesn't get you to listen,
that's right.
I don't know what will.
I'm staying right here.
You're staying right here. He's not going to be right here. But okay.
I know, but still.
But still,
I can listen from here.
In principle,
I got my headphones on.
There you go, guys. Thank you so much. Thank you to our chat room, Matt Carlins, Garza, Bobby FJ Town, so many more throughout the night. Juggalo John, tell us about being taught by Shane Douglas back in the day. See you guys next time. Mayhem out. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com. You guys are cool.